we're all stuck.
I think we're all stuck, yeah.
I think we're stuck.
Yeah. Can we do a replay on
that? Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
So the game jam for our class, game design, is a weekly assignment we do with groups with other game design students, and we try to make a game with each other, and usually we're given constraints like what kind of engine or like what kind of themes we have to incorporate into the game.
So game jams in general, they are very chaotic because it's always a race against time. That can be said for game development as a whole, but with game jams, it's always very compact. So it was very chaotic, very strange. We're trying to work together while also getting to know each other and like trying to make the game within the parameters, but also make something very creative. And that's the best part about the jams, is that you have to make something very fast, so you cut through all of the problems very fast. And it allows you to come up with some crazy wild ideas. So it was difficult, but very, very interesting too at the same time.
The process of our games being greenlit by our teachers is when we're finished our game jam, our week game jam, we showcase our games to the teachers. And then from there, they decide whether they want us to put the game into full production or not. And full production is essentially the like lead game designer is responsible for hiring interns, polishing the game and finishing it up so we can bring it to showcases and send demos of it out to people.
So for this last week, I made a music-based game called Lyra. It's inspired from games such as Zelda and Kingdom Hearts. Essentially, the music in the world has been taken away. So you have to investigate and figure out why the music is gone and try to restore the music. And the constraints for that particular game jam were it had to be made in Unreal, had to include the monomyth, and it had to have a logic puzzle.
The game for this week, I'm not participating in this particular game jam, but the one I made before was a game based on Haggis. The principle behind Haggis Quest is that it's a 2D platformer, and you're playing as this little Scottish potato guy, and you're going around the place, the environment, trying to get to your goal. It's a vertical platformer, not a horizontal one. But the trick is, since in the game you have to be invisible for half of the game, we implemented a system where half of the assets in the game are invisible when the other half are visible. So when you can see your player and your enemies, the items and platforms become invisible, so you don't know what they are. But you can switch it up, and then you can see the items and the platforms, but now you can see the enemies and your player's position. So you have to constantly keep switching between each vision, trying to memorize, like, I'm here, I gotta go there, it's about this huge of a gap, okay, I'm gonna clear it, there's an enemy there, memorize the pattern of the shots from the enemies, where they're going, their pathing, and that's basically the huge challenge, trying to traverse an environment where you're not always 100% sure of where things are.
And our game is called Paddle Battle, and it's a multiplayer game where two people sit and control either canoe, you're in canoes, and then the goal of it is to get close to the other canoe and to tip the other players out of their canoe. Well, the cues for our game jam were that it had to be a car combat game, there had to be no real world violence.
Nobody could die.
Nobody could die.
And it had to be done in the Unity engine, I think that was the four.
Yeah, it had to be done in Unity engine, you're right. So we wanted to do something, if we couldn't have it kind of like rooted in reality in a violent way, we wanted it to just be kind of like silly and fun and something kind of relatable. So Paddle Battle was what I was, I guess, naturally drawn to.